Thank you. So this is joint work that I've done with Frédéric Dupuis that is here this week, Serge Fire from the Netherlands, and Louis Salvay, my supervisor in Montreal. So we're talking about adaptive and non-adaptive strategies, so let me just define that on the first slide. So forget everything you know about adaptivity in cryptography. This is the only definition that you're going to have to work with the rest of my slides. So we say that an adversary, in general, is adaptive if it has access to some side information that's correlated in some way to the honest participant. So we're going to have, of course, classical and quantum side information. And we say that the adversary is non-adaptive if it has no access to such side information. So I'm going to introduce what I mean by side information with a simple example. So you have two players, Alice and Bob, and Alice plays the part of the adversary. And they're going to share two random variables. This is a classical case of adaptivity, so they share random variables X and Y. So you can think of Y as either the whole memory of the honest participant or some value that he wants to keep secret. And the correlation between X and Y classically is described by a joint probability distribution over the possible values. So you can think of these values as being generated by a previous protocol, being given by a third party or anything. And they play a game where the goal is for Alice to produce a J that will determine some function that Bob will apply on his value, and Bob will either output pass or fail. And the goal of Alice is to compute a function of her side information that will make Bob output pass. And for some fixed distribution and set of function h of j, we're going to define the adaptive success probability, which is the case where Alice has access to classical side information, and she's just going to maximize over all classical functions that maximizes her probability of passing the test. And the non-adaptive case is where Alice does not have access to j, so her best strategy is just where Alice has no access to X, so her best strategy is just to choose the J that will maximize her probability. So classically, you can very easily control what advantage you get by having side information, because a possible non-adaptive strategy is just to guess the value of the side information and apply the corresponding adaptive attack. So you get the non-adaptive success probability is at least the probability of guessing the side information. This is 2 to the power minus 10 if you have n bits of side information, times the probability of success of the corresponding adaptive attack. And if you rearrange those terms, you get what we call a adaptive versus non-adaptive relation, which upper bounds the adaptive success probability in terms of the non-adaptive success probability. So this is an exponential blowout that we have to pay, but it gives a non-trivial bound as long as you can control the size of the side information and the success probability for non-adaptive adversaries. Right, so our goal is to have something similar in the quantum setting. So we're going to look at the quantum version of our game. So in the quantum version of our game, you have Alice and Bob also. Alice is the adversary, and she holds quantum side information that we denote A. And the honest participant, Bob, has some quantum state B that is entangled with B, and this correlation, this entanglement, is described by the joint state of Alice and Bob. So now the goal is the same. Alice wants to produce J, such that Bob now performs a measurement that is specified by J, which is either pass or fail. And adaptive Alice will maximize over all measurement on her state that will produce this output J by using her quantum side information A. And the non-adaptive success probability is the same, so she just chooses the J that maximizes the probability that Bob's outcome will pass. But now quantum adaptivity is much more difficult to analyze because the specifics of quantum information, when Alice performs some measurement and gets some output J, this has an effect on Bob's register if they are entangled. So Bob's state will collapse to some some state that is unknown to him, but that may be known to the adversary, and that may give the adversary some advantage in order to cheat a scheme, or in this case, to pass the test. So we'd like to have an adaptive versus non-adaptive relation for quantum information as well, but there is no direct translation of the last argument that we had, because it doesn't make sense to guess quantum side information. So we can use the following analogy. Well, what we did pretty much in a classical case is we replaced the side information X with a uniform random guess. So now you can take the joint probability mass function of X and Y, and you can trivially upper bound it by 2 to the power of n probability of guessing X times the probability of getting Y. And if you replace this mass function in the adaptive, the definition of the adaptive success probability, then this gets upper bounded by the same thing when you replace it by the right-hand side, and this gets you the non-adaptive success probability. So we can think, we can rearrange our argument this way, and now this has a closest quantum analog, so you can replace Alice's state with the completely uniform state, which is the stage on which she has maximum uncertainty. Then you can show that the joint state of Alice and Bob is upper bounded by this uniform state tensor Bob's state by paying some price of 2 to the power of 2n. And so now we see that Alice and Bob are completely uncorrelated. And I have to take a moment to explain this inequality, because on the left-hand side we have real numbers, and on the right-hand side we have matrices. So this is, for people that are familiar with it, it's the partial order on complex matrices that's induced by positive semi-definite matrices. But the only thing that we need to know for the purpose of this talk is that if you feed rho to some measurement apparatus, then the probability that you get outcome X is upper bounded by the probability that you get the same outcome by feeding sigma instead. So now, since the adaptive success probability is the probability of some outcome on a measurement on rho AB, then you get that the adaptive success probability is upper bounded by this factor times the same measurement on the right-hand side, but since this is completely uncorrelated, this is a non-adaptive attack. All right? So we got some sort of quantum A versus NA relation, but we have an additional factor 2 that is unfortunate, and the question is, can we get rid of it? And in fact, we can, but this, because this holds very generally, but it's tight. There are some states where AB for which the smallest constant, the smallest factor that you can choose is this one. And I forgot to mention n is the number of qubits that Alice holds. All right, so our main result is that we can get rid of this factor 2, and we can even improve on that. If we consider just the game that I described, then for this particular game, for any state that Alice and Bob receive, and for any measurement on Bob's part, then we recover the adaptive versus non-adaptive relation. So having access to n qubits can only increase Alice's success probability by 2 to the power of n. And in fact, we can show something a little bit better. We can show that it's upper bounded by 2 to the power of lambda times the adaptive success probability, where lambda has a pretty complex definition, but it's pretty much the minimal amount that we have to pay in order to uncorrelate the measurement result of Alice and Bob's register. All right, so this gives us a pretty very powerful relation to analyze quantum cryptographic scheme, because we can reduce the adaptive attacks to the non-adaptive attacks that are much easier to analyze. So we'll demonstrate that by showing two applications of our result. So the first one is to show that the primitive one-bit cut and choose is universal. So I'll introduce this cryptographic primitive. So generally, m-bit cut and choose, you have an input x on Alice's side that has size m. On Bob's side, you have an input C. Alice just gets Bob's input, and Bob will get Alice's input if C is equal to 1, and if C is equal to 0, he gets nothing. So at first glance, it's really not clear that this primitive is useful for anything. And in fact, in the classical world, you have an infinite hierarchy of cut and chooses that are specified by the input length, in which every member is strictly weaker than the one after it. So 2cc can be used to implement 1cc, but 1cc cannot implement 2cc, for example. However, in the quantum world, things change quite dramatically. So you have a very nice paper by Serge Frère, Jonathan Katz, and others in 2013 that say that in quantum two-party cryptography, almost every two-party primitive is either trivial, which means that it can be implemented by a protocol, a quantum protocol, either universal, so it can be used as a black box in a quantum protocol to implement any two-party task, or can implement an XOR, which is equivalent to just swapping the input of the respective parties. And so I say almost in parentheses, because they were able to show that the infinite classical hierarchy collapses to the second level, but they were unable to show whether 1cc, to which three categories 1cc belong. And so we show in our paper that 1cc is universal for two-party cryptography. And the proof is pretty complicated because the paper concerns quantum universally composable security, which is a very strong notion of security. And so I'm just going to sketch the proof for a much simpler notion of security, but you'll still get all the intuition from where the cryptographic power of 1cc comes within a quantum protocol. So briefly, so the proof idea is that we use 1cc as a black box in a quantum protocol to implement bit commitment. It has been known for quite some time that bit commitment can be used as a black box in a quantum protocol to implement OT, and OT is complete for two-party cryptography. So we're going to show how we can implement this implication. So for people who are not familiar with it, bit commitment is a primitive where the sender puts, you can imagine it as a safe. So the sender puts a bit in a safe, keeps the key, sends the safe. And then after some time, in the, if he wants to reveal the bit, he just sends the key and the receiver can open the safe. So our bit commitment protocol is going to, I'm just going to briefly sketch what we can consider as a preparation phase. So Alice is going to choose a random string theta, and she's going to send to Bob a quantum state that is specified by the B92 encoding specified by theta. And this B92 encoding, so for a specific bit of theta, if this bit is zero, she sends the zero computational basis state. And if this bit is one, she sends an equal superposition of 0 and 1. And so we denote the state that Bob receives by rho b. And since Bob doesn't know theta, he has uncertainty about the state that he has received. All right, so afterwards, we're going to use the 1cc primitive. So Alice is going to input first the first bit of theta in the 1cc primitive. Bob is going to choose at random if he wants to see this theta or not. So he's going to want to look at some of the position and still have some uncertainty about the others. So Alice will see if Bob has checked this position or not. And then if Bob did choose to open the cut and choose, he will get theta, which then allows him to verify that the state of his first qubit is the right state that Alice was supposed to send. So they repeat this for every position. And effectively, what this step does is what is called quantum sampling. So quantum sampling is a very nice result by Serge Frère and Nick Buhmann. And they say that you can observe a quantum, random positions of a quantum state. And from the measurement result of those positions, you can infer something about the rest of the state. All right, so this is a quantum sampling, so that the CIs specify a sampling of the positions that Bob will observe. So Alice knows which position were observed and which were not, so they can both agree on the positions that remain on which there is still uncertainty. And what quantum sampling says is that after this step, the joint state of Alice and Bob is close to this. So if Alice was dishonest and wanted to stay entangled with the Bob state, then she could only be entangled with some error. So on Bob's side, you have almost the right state that Alice was supposed to send, plus some error vector, some error pattern. And Alice is only entangled with those patterns. And since the number of errors is a parameter of the sampling, we can control the size of the number of entanglement that Alice holds. And it's not too hard to show that the 2 to the power of lambda factor in our main result is upper bounded by the number of possible error patterns. And so this yields an easy proof, because from this we can construct a bit commitment scheme that is secure against non-adaptive adversary. And then we just apply our main result with this bound on the size of the side information, and we can show security very easily using our A versus any relation. All right, so this is it for the first application. The second application of our main result concerns the security of the BCGL bit commitment scheme, which I will introduce just now. So a historic perspective of quantum bit commitment scheme, the BCGL bit commitment, I'm spoiling ahead. The BCGL bit commitment scheme was proposed in 93, around 1993, by Brassard, Crépeau, Jossa, and Langlois as a unconditionally secure quantum bit commitment. And of course, back then, this was still thought to be possible. But now, as most of you probably know, quantum mechanics alone do not allow to implement bit commitment, as was shown independently by Meyers and Low and Cho. And you have to wait quite a few years before there starts to appear a new proposal for bit commitment, quantum bit commitment, that rely only on realistic physical assumptions. So you have Damgard, Fer, Salvay, and Schaffner that proposed in 2005 a bit commitment scheme that is secure under the assumption that the adversary can only store a limited amount of qubits. And again, some years later, you have a different physical assumption. This one is the noisy storage model, though. So it was introduced by Koenig, Wenner, and Buschleger. And their assumption basically is that the adversary cannot reliably store a lot of information. So there will be some noise model applied to its memory before it tries to access it. So we have those two schemes with physical assumptions that implement bit commitment, but the techniques involved do not apply to BCGL, and I will elaborate on that in just one slide. So the security of the BCGL scheme was never revisited since it was proposed in 93. So now we're going to look at the differences between those schemes and BCGL, which makes it hard to analyze. So for the bounded storage and noisy storage schemes, it's the receiver's memory that is either bounded or noisy. So the receiver of the quantum information has a bound on its memory. And what this does is that you have knowledge over the state that the adversary holds, because it's prepared by the honest participant. So this allows you to use uncertainty relations to lower bound the uncertainty that the adversary has on its measurement outcome when measuring the state. And so these techniques don't seem to apply easily to the BCGL scheme for the following reason. In the BCGL scheme, it's the sender of quantum information that has more power. So it's the sender's memory that needs to be bounded. This means that the adversary can prepare an arbitrary state. We have absolutely no control over it. And so you cannot apply, at least not directly, uncertainty relations. And it's difficult to see whether you could at all. But with our adaptive versus non-adaptive relation, as long as we have some control over the memory of the adversary and that we know how to prove the scheme secure in the non-adaptive settings, then we can show that the scheme is secure. And this is what we do. So we need the following assumption. So we have to have some bound on the adversary's memory, which is characterized by lambda, the parameter from our main result. So we need an upper bound on lambda, and in the bounded storage model, this is readily available because we have upper bounded lambda by the number of qubits that the adversary can store. But we still don't know how to do it in the noisy storage model, and we would like to do that in the future. All right, and the second assumption that we need is that the adversary can only perform projective measurements. So this is usually a pretty strong assumption, but since we already bound the adversary's quantum capabilities, it's somehow mitigated. And actually, this assumption is because of our proof technique, and we don't believe that we need it at all, but we were unable to show that we were unable to get rid of it. Right. And what we show is that if a scheme that we call non-interactive, I'll go back on this in a second, is epsilon binding against non-adaptive adversary, then it is binding against adaptive adversaries that satisfy those two assumptions with a corresponding loss in the security parameter. And our theorem applies generally to non-interactive schemes. A scheme is non-interactive if all the information goes from the committer to the verifier. So from the sender to the receiver, you only have one-way communication. And the BCGL scheme satisfies this criteria. So our theorem applies to the BCGL scheme. And of course, the BCGL scheme is easy to show secure for non-adaptive adversary. So from this, we get a security result for adaptive adversaries. All right. So just to conclude, the main takeaway is that quantum adaptivity is really hard to analyze compared to classical adaptivity, as we have defined it. And we then show how we can reduce quantum adaptivity to quantum adaptive attacks to quantum non-adaptive attacks, which are much easier to analyze. And we apply this result to solve the main questions of this paper and obtain the first security result on the BCGL scheme. Thank you.